feel right now on the mountaintop. I can see so clear what it's all about. So stay by my side when the sun goes down. Don't wanna forget how I feel right now. Jireh, Jireh, you are enough.
I know that you are.
Jireh,
you are
enough.
So
I will be
even in this right now,
in every circle.
Good morning. This is the day. But I'm real happy. I am real happy. I'm excited about life, and I'm excited to be in the presence of God and His people this morning. Unfortunately for somebody, Virginia, I think me to talk too much spirit, we had a little time yesterday, and so I don't know what you might get today, so, but we got company, but that's never stopped me before, so, I don't know if it's going to stop me today. But I am excited to be in your presence today. I am excited to be anywhere today because God is good. Yeah. And God is doing some things, and I am so excited. I think I got the debut single for my gospel album. I was working on it this morning. I'm coming down, so I know we're going to work hard.
But I thought
Rachel was leaving. I said gospel album, he's probably leaving.
He said gospel.
He wouldn't do that to me. He might. That's okay. Okay, we'll make this work. Actually, okay, all right. We're gonna try something, and then we gonna get this. That was how it worked?
Yeah.
You good? Yeah. Okay. Got that. All right. Let's see. We've talked about this before. You can always tell when something amazing is about to happen. Because little stuff starts to go wrong.
Yeah.
And it's all a distraction.
Yeah.
Because we need to keep focused on what God has called and created us to do. And so today we have been called and created not just to occupy some space, but we have been called and created to worship our God, to bring Him the glory that He so richly deserves. Because He brought us what we could not get for ourselves. He gave us life. It wasn't just our parents coming together. It was the thought of God. God thought about you before time began. He had you in His mind. And He said on September 10th, 2023, I want them in my house celebrating me with my other kids. And so that's what we came to do. But not only did we come to do it, but God in His foreknowledge said, you know what? I'm going to give somebody the wisdom and the creativity to invent the internet. And then I'm going to give somebody else the creativity to build Zoom and Facebook. And then I'm going to give the pastor at least enough sense to make sure that people on Zoom and Facebook can celebrate me too. So we have gathered, by whatever definition you want to use for gathering, but we are here to celebrate the same God. And so if you haven't guessed a little bit, I know the call to worship says I was glad. I done passed glad about 3 hours ago.
All right.
And I am so overwhelmed to be in the house of the Lord today. And if you want to be overwhelmed with me, I invite you to stand that we might sing the doxology. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Is better than 1,000 I had rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness.
Because the house of the Lord our God, I will seek your good.
Ernie, I told you this yesterday. Those that are planted in the house of the Lord, they shall flourish in the courts of our God.
Thank you. your arms. You were my shelter from the storm.
To praise you and to say thank you. Father God, we thank you for this wonderful weekend that we have had. Father God, we get real. We thank you. Related, educated, and liberated. Father God, we praise you because some were free this weekend. Father God, we have been liberated. We have been liberated to praise you, to worship you, and to say thank you. You did it all. And Father God, I could stand here and give you a 10 million words, but they aren't necessary. Because our hearts, Lord, is glad. Father God, we could not wait to come within these consecrated walls today to praise you, to sing, and to say thank you. And Father God, there is a lot going on in the world. So, Father God, I ask right now that you would bless this country. Father God, bless his leaders. Father God, that they will lead with love and remember the people that they are serving. And Father God, as we remember you, let us ever be thankful for whatever situation that we're in. Paul says to be thankful in all things, not for all things, but be thankful for in all things. And Father God, we praise you, we lift you up, and we magnify your name. Father God, as you have already entered the building, we thank you. And Father God, I ask right now that you would bless our pastor. Father God, that he would give us a rhema word today. And Father God, as we leave this place and we go back into the world, may we remember whose we are and who we serve. And Father God, it doesn't matter what's going on around us. Run our race and be constant in our race. Father God, this is my prayer. In your darling son Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
As the media team brings up the scripture, I'm going to invite you to share the scripture with me. As we read the scripture, will be from 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1, we will be reading verses 13 through 22. 1 Peter chapter 1, reading verses 13 to 22, and I invite you there on the screen so that we can share from the same version. Hopefully, the print is big enough for some of us. But let us read, not at our own pace, but let us read together. Therefore, gird up your loins of your mind, be sober, and rest your hope fully upon the grace that is to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, not conforming yourselves to the former lusts, as in your ignorance, but as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct. Because it is written, be holy, for I am holy. And if you call on the Father, who without partiality judges, according to each one's work, conduct yourselves throughout the time of your stay here in fear, knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things, like silver or gold, from your aimless conduct received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spots. He indeed
glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. Since you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit in sincere love of the brethren, love one another fervently with a pure heart.
The Word of God for the people of God. Please do what God has said.
Amen.
Amen. Minister Brian, choir.
I'm gonna give God a hand of praise. I noticed the mics went out while we were singing a few minutes ago. So I'm trying to make sure the mics are working. Amen. Because I want the people that are on the Zoom to be able to hear us as well. Amen. And I want to hear us too. Amen. What y'all want to say? I'm sorry, we didn't have no rehearsal this week, so I want to know what y'all want to say. I'm telling everybody, they didn't come.
Let them use.
I don't want to say that we ain't comfortable with this. I tell y'all what, let's go back.
Oh,
to the goodness. Let everything that have breath praise the Lord. If you got breath in your body, praise Him. If you got hands that clap, praise Him. If you got feet to stand, honor the Lord. If you got knees to bow, reverence the Lord. Come on, give Him glory, give Him glory. He inhabits the praise of His people. He inhabits the praise of His people. He gets in, He lives in, He abides in the praise of His people.
Than to open your mouth and prove it. And there are some points where we just need to shut up and be. Now, I apologize. I'm like, oh, the pastor said shut up and be. Because I needed to speak it in a language that you would understand. Sometimes we need to just leave there and not talk about being there. It's like standing in front of the most beautiful sunrise you've ever seen, and somebody got to narrate it. Don't narrate the sunrise. Just be. Don't narrate God. Just be. Bask in the presence, in the glory of God. And maybe if we would spend more time just being, when we leave, we would be like Moses. And the Bible said when he came down from the mountaintop, his face shone with the glory of God. I hate to know what our face is showing when we leave here. But sometimes I don't think it's the glory of God. So for a moment, let's just be. Talisha, I agree. He's in the place. And because he's here, we should just be. It was not in the storm. It was not in the earthquake. But it was in the still small voice. And maybe if we're quiet, we can hear what he has to say. Let us pray. Eternal God, help us to learn how to be silent before you. God, we live in such a noisy world that silence is uncomfortable. Still, this feels wrong. But at this moment, God, I sense you simply saying, be still. And know me. God, we came into this place testifying to the fact that we wanted to have a relationship with you. That we wanted to abide in your presence. But then we've done everything to not do that. And God, for a moment in our spirits, in the deepest parts of who we are, speak to us like you spoke to the storm. Peace! Be still. God, the word says that you said that to the storm, but I got to believe you said it to the 12 brothers in the boat, too.
because they were anything but still. And God, in the deep parts of who we are, we're not still either. So while our hands might not be moving, while our feet might not be tapping, everything in us is churning. The person sitting next to me can't see it, God, but you can. Help us to still that part of us, so that deep within us we will know that you are God. Not just God around us, but God in us. Thank you, Father, for wanting to be with us. Help us to sense and have a profound sense of your presence in this moment and every moment to come. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you. As for the announcements for the day, let me just, this is really, I have two announcements I really want to do, the rest of them, and we'll get to, if we get to. Thank you for everybody who had anything to do with the conference this weekend. For those who sang, for those who showed up, for those who just sat there, for those who did something. Lisa Cochran, I apologize. Yesterday when I was going through my thank yous, I forgot to thank you for all the work you did to help us get this stuff together. And I know you don't want it, but I need to say it because I'm grateful to you. But I definitely want to thank you. It was a weekend that absolutely blew my mind. Because I watched God do what he promised me he would do. And I told Ernie this when we were talking about it, he wouldn't let me fail. I tried real hard to fail. I tried real hard to get Ernie to tell me, he ain't coming, because you ain't called me, God. But every time I called that fool, yeah, let's go, we're doing this. I'm like, yo, gang, just tell me you ain't coming so I cancel this thing. But God wouldn't let me fail, and he wouldn't let this fail, which tells me something about what's coming next. And so I'm at a level of excitement that I have not been in a long time. I am grateful to God. In her absence and the absence of all those from New Birth community, I thank them once again. I will let all of you know, I share that. For those of you who weren't there, I just want to let you know that I had, this is really for those who were there, I have called TSA, and I have given pictures to all of those who sat in Reverend Kathy Merritt's class, and said if they present you a boarding pass to Charlotte, North Carolina, you turn them around. They are not allowed to leave. I know, but again, God said he was going to do it, he did it, so I thank him, and I thank all of you for being here. Go ahead to the next slide. Please ask that you continue to give. Giving is part of our worship. Yes, being silent is a part, shouting is a part, but sharing is also a part. And so we challenge you just to do what God said to do and give. Next slide. Sunday school is a blessing, and when's he gonna stop talking about it? I'm gonna stop talking when everybody shows up. When everybody shows up. When I'm getting to the point where Zoom is telling me that I gotta get more people, I gotta extend it, or people are calling me saying, I tried to get them, I couldn't get on. Because we were at the limit. Then maybe I'll stop. No, actually, I'm just gonna increase the number of people to get on. And we're getting more people from there. But look, again, never mind. Next slide. Study the Bible. Young people, we have a chance for you to study the Bible. Come tomorrow night at 6 p.m. Come study the Bible. Next slide. Men. Woo-hoo! Come study the Bible. I do want to thank the brothers especially. We talked about whether or not we were going to have men's Bible study last week. I did note that the only people who said no were the women. Said they couldn't understand. So we had Bible study anyway, and I want to thank the brothers that came, the brothers that didn't. You were doing your ministry. You were doing what you needed to do. But we had Bible study, and we had a great time, and so we will be back there tomorrow night. And actually, the cool part about it is, it's tomorrow night's the first Monday Night Football game of the year. But here's the beautiful thing. I'll have double-digit brothers in Bible study. That's because we have men who care about knowing the Word of God. Amen. And so I celebrate that because everybody told me when we started this, brothers ain't coming on Monday night. I don't know what your brothers are doing, but my brothers in Bible study on Monday night. Because we have decided God is more important than the NFL. All right, next slide. On Wednesday, our midweek Bible study, we will be in, I think we're still in Romans 12. We might venture to Romans. Jackie, will let me get to Romans 13? No. Okay, so Jackie has decided we are staying in Romans 12. So we will be in Romans 12, last, I think we're 9 through 21. We're going to work our way through that. It was getting good. We just kind of scratched the surface of that last week. So we're going to pull out the picks and the shovels, and we're going to get deeper into that. So come on out. We will be here in person and on Zoom and on Facebook, so we encourage you to come out and be a part of that. And then next, our Thursday, Double Blessing Bible Study, which is a lot of fun for me. But I invite you to come. You're doing real good at keeping it at an hour so that you can keep your job. So wherever you are at, we invite you to Zoom in or to join on Facebook. And I will say, I'm here from 12 to 1. So if you happen to be around and just want to come and be here in person, you are more than welcome to do that. I'm not telling you can. I just know people are out doing whatever they're doing. And so, but we want to invite you to be a part of that. I can't continue to tell you that the Word of God is important and not offer you opportunities to study the Word. And so, and if there's another Bible study that's needed, if there's another focus that's needed, you let me know, and we will make, we will find time. We will make time. Looking for young people to join, be a part of the choir. If you're interested, please see Mr. Bryant, so that we can continue our music ministry. Go ahead, go to the next slide. And then as far as the, now I had a moment, every once in a while I have that moment where I'm sitting there, I got my, because you know, I got my eyes closed. And then I'm like, look at the 27 people get behind me in the choir. They have enough room for that many people. And then I turn around and go, oh, there's 7. But when we get to 27, we gonna, the people down the street are going to be like, what is going on in there? Yeah, come on in. And so, but we invite you, sopranos. Hold. Get my note?
No.
Can't find my note? He ain't even move, man. Look at that love, man. He ain't even move. All right. But hey, so we're looking for somebody, because if you don't sing, I'm going to have to. How about that? Now all of a sudden, we have 412 people in the choir. Won't be nobody sitting out there. But what are we going to do? What's up? We're going to do, we're going to come out with it. We're just going to okay, so, hey, I got a phone call. They were looking for a place to hold the citywide prayer revival. And since last I checked, his house was supposed to be called the House of Prayer. On the 28th of September, we will be having a prayer revival here at St. Mary. And so that is a Thursday night. I invite you to come on out and be a part of that. Let's pray for the city. Let's pray for what's going on. Because somewhere it said, if my people, not if the Democrats, not if the Republicans, not if my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray, and seek my face, and this last one, and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, and I will heal their land and forgive us. If our land, if we want the land healed, there's a thing we need to do. And so I want to challenge us to be a part of that on the 28th of September here at St. Mary. Okay? Okay, so on this Saturday, on the 16th, we'll have the Shreveport Monroe District Annual Conference Reporting Meeting. It is just our opportunity as the pastors and the delegates to come together and get us ready, geared up towards annual conference. And so if you want to attend, you are more than welcome. I know Sister Price, our delegate, will be there. I will be there. And if you want to be there as well, I think Sister Lack, you probably should be there too.
The area that
you missed. Oh, okay. You should be there too.
You're
okay. Oh, actually, you know what? Brother Wade, I need you to, I might need you tomorrow night. I want to do this. Because I think they called another annual conference meeting to start Monday night at 7. I'm trying to train them to know that I'm a little busy,
But just in case I have to break away, I'm going to tag you in. So I just wanted to get that out there now before calling you tomorrow at 5:30 saying, hey, man, you need to be ready. So on the 30th of September, just another day, on that other day, we are going to invite you to come over to our house so that we can celebrate you. This is all about you. Now, I'm making this point. I'm standing in the pulpit. I'm standing in the place of God. Do not bring me a birthday gift. Because it's not about that. Because I know you're going to do it anyway, but I got to say it on camera. That I'm not inviting someone. Oh, who's doing this? No, I'm not. It was just the best Saturday to do it. I am not looking for you to bring anything but an appetite and a willingness to get beaten spades. That's all I need you to bring. But if you do bring something, thank you. But please, don't. Somebody's going to say, I didn't have nothing to bring, so I didn't come. This is not about that. This is a member appreciation. If you are a member, we want you to come so we can appreciate you. Fix your face. We love you. We love you and we want you to come. So please, start at 2 or whenever you decide to show up, and we'll be there, food will be there, the game will be there, the fun will be there. Please show up on the 30th. Okay, good. Also, did anybody not get the survey that I sent out? Did anybody not? You still didn't get the survey? You must have some bad things to say. No, I'm just kidding. All right, I'm going to say that. Can you get it in? I know why you didn't get it. All right, but please, for those of you who did get the survey, please fill it out. Because, again, we're moving in a direction. But I tell you this, I'm not the only one God talks to. God is speaking things into you. But if they stay in you, they will never get out here. And so if you're not comfortable coming and talking to me, which actually scares me to death that if you're not comfortable coming to talk to me, put it on the survey. Say, Pastor, I think we might need to look into doing this. Because I don't want to stay in the same place. We have somewhere to go. God has stuff for us to do. And so I invite you to fill out the survey, come talk to me, so that we can move this church to the level that God wants it to be. Okay? All right, that's enough. There's not enough. Mark's Frank Daily Breads, for all of us who are visually challenged, for October, November, and December, they are available. They're on the back table. They're in the fellowship hall. Please grab one, take it to somebody that needs to have the Word of God so that they can share with them. Okay? All right, that's all I have. Mr. Brian, if you and the choir, please get us ready for the preaching moment. Thank you. Larry, how do you feel? If it's not an imposition, can I hear a little bit of Yes, God is Real?
Yeah.
Or from the choir, can I hear a little bit of Yes, God is Real? that to you. And I never told your father I could do that to him. So thank you, Larry. I appreciate you. Because I wanted to hear that simply because God has been so real in this season. And yes, God is real. Thank you to Reverend Gentry for leading us in prayer. Thank you to Minister Bride and the choir for leading us in worship. Thank you to the doorkeepers. Because we read, I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God. Because you stand up here in the kingdom of God does not make you any better than those who stand back there. And so I am grateful to those who are our doorkeepers. The scripture that we all read together was 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 13 through 22. We read it together out of the New King James Version. I'm going to present it to you out of the Christian Standard Bible. 1 Peter chapter 1, beginning at verse 13. Here it says, "Therefore, with your minds ready for action, be sober-minded and set your hope completely on the grace to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, do not be conformed to the distress, the desires of your former ignorance, but as the one who called you is holy, you also are to be holy in all your conduct. For it is written, 'Be holy, because I am holy.' If you appeal to the Father who judges impartially according to each one's work, you are to conduct yourselves in reverence during your time living as strangers. For you know that you were redeemed from your empty way of life, inherited from your fathers, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of an unblemished and spotless lamb. For he was foreknown before the foundation of the world, but was revealed in these last times for you. Through him, you believe in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. Since you have purified yourselves by your obedience to the truth, so that you show sincere brotherly love for each other, from a pure heart, love one another constantly." For a few moments, I want to speak to you from the topic, from the subject, using these scriptures as a basis. Keep it real. Keep it real. Let's pray. Eternal God, indeed you are real. And we have spent this year talking about getting real. But Lord, in this moment, we pray that every fake thing in us, you would burn up right now in the glory of your presence. God, we need your word. We need the fire that comes from you. We don't want it, God. We need it. And we need you now to speak to us in such a way that we change forever. Lord, we need to be transformed. And whatever barrier is standing in that way, God, we pray that you would remove it now by the power of your word. And I'm here to be used. I'm not worthy. I'm not fully capable. But I am fully willing. So God, I ask that you would use me one more time, that the word that is spoken will make a difference. Because you're a God who wants us to be different. But we thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I know for a while, I don't know if people still talk about it as much, but there was a while where everybody, it seemed like everybody talking was talking about, "I'm just keeping it real. I'm just keeping it real. I'm just keeping it real." And it's every time you say something, "No, man, don't worry about it, I'm just keeping it real." And all I could think of, you're keeping it real stupid. You're keeping it real broke. You're keeping it real loud. I mean, what is this it that you are keeping real? Because whatever it is, it doesn't seem to be working. And I shared with you before that I had an English teacher back in, I think, the 11th, 10th, or 11th grade, who anytime you wrote a paper, Reverend Gentry, if you had the word it in there, it was an unclear it, you automatically got a 50F. If you, so you said it was going on, 50F, because she's like, I don't know what it is. And so I need to know what it is so that I can understand what you're talking about. And so for all of us who are keeping it real, what is your it? Is it just the time you spend in this building? Is it your marriage? Is it your time at school? Is it the way you study? Is it how you raise your kids? Because that's what needs to be real. As a matter of fact, we probably shouldn't say keeping it real. We should be saying keeping everything real. And of course, when we talk about real, we talk about being related, educated, and liberated. We talk about allowing God to come into us and remove all the lies that we've been living. And it's exciting to get something. The question is, can you keep it? How many of us as parents, and I'll say it this way, how many of us parents have watched our parents give something to our kids, knowing our kids couldn't keep it? They just gave them stuff because the kid asked for it. And we sitting there going, they ain't going to keep it. They ain't old enough. They ain't responsible enough to handle it. I still don't understand why a 7-year-old has a cell phone. I'm trying to figure out why a 7-year-old has a cell phone that's more expensive than mine. 7-year-old can't keep. I went to the school one day, and the lost and found, and there were underwear in the lost and found. And I'm thinking, if we got kids that can't keep track of their underwear, how are we giving them a $500 phone? They got it, but they can't keep it. And I'm afraid after what we did this year, after we've done this weekend, we got real. Oh, yesterday was real. Yesterday was about as real as the Shreveport has ever been. So we got real, but my question is, will we keep it? Will it just be someday that we talk about, oh, y'all remember back in September? Woo! Didn't we have a good time? And we go back to doing what we've been doing the whole time. We came up one way, we had a one-day transformation, and then we went back. It'd be like a butterfly, a caterpillar, who walked around, got in the cocoon, broke out of the cocoon, and said, oh, this is cool. Let me get back in that cocoon. Because I don't want to fly. Flying is different. Flying is challenging. The wind bothers you when you fly. I'm going to go back to walking. Now, they got real when they became a butterfly because that's who they really were. But they didn't want to keep it real. And I, Mr. Chandelier, I'm looking at you because if I look at some of the people that I'm thinking about right now, they're going to be offended, but I got some butterflies that are trying to get back in the cocoon. We broke out yesterday. We set some things free. We threw some things down. And now we're trying to get that back up so I can put that back on again. Because that was a little bit too real. And God is saying to us, will we keep it real? Will we keep our lives real? God has been trying to break us out. As a matter of fact, remember, all of us who have read the book of Exodus, it was all about them being broken out. They weren't really supposed to be slaves. And God said, I am setting you free. And they spent 40 years talking about, can we go back? Yes, remember the leeks and onions. So wait, God is feeding you supernaturally every day. But you want slave food. Because free food was too real. It's the same here. This is going to be this is just me and you right now. And so as we look at Peter, because Peter, 1 Peter 2, 1 through 16, those are the verses. And some of you are shocked. Is that the verse we've been talking about here? Yes, yeah, the verse on the back of your t-shirt that we gave you. About getting real. Because Peter was telling us all the different things that we need to do to get real. And that was in chapter 2. But I thought it was amazing that when I read chapter 1, I found out, hey, here's what you need to keep real. And as you read verses 13 through 22, very simply, very clearly, Paul Peter comes through and he says, hey, here's what what you need to keep real. See, Peter, this letter was written to a bunch of people who were struggling at a time that was contrary to Christianity. I know that's so different than 2023. Some of us might not understand. But Peter was writing to people who were suffering, who were struggling, who were going through some things. And in the midst of their going through, he simply said to them, I need you to keep it real. If you've been saved, if you've been taken out of the kingdom of darkness and put in the kingdom of light, I need you to keep it real. Well, keep it real what? Can I keep it real rich? Because that's what the prosperity people say. Well, the rest of us look at our bank account, but I can't keep it rich if I ain't ever been rich. So it has nothing to do with how much money I got. It doesn't have anything to do with how my status in the world. This has to do with what's going on in me and how God wants to work through me. And so very simply, if we start at verse 13, I think you guys can actually preach this sermon for me. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 13, it says, therefore, with your minds ready for action, be sober and set your hope completely on the grace of God that will be revealed in Jesus Christ. See, we've got to keep it hopeful because we've been set up with promises. So many things that God wants to do. And for us to walk around and say, it'll never be good. It'll never be better. Well, that's not keeping it real, because then that means God's promises. Somewhere I think it still says, does it still say that God's not a man? That he should lie? Or the Son of Man, that he should not, that God, if any of his promises not come true? They've all come true, so how can we, who claim we are real now, we are related to God, look up and go, nothing's going to be right. Yeah. I got to tell you, one of my issues, and I shared this yesterday with a couple of people, because we had just finished the conference, we had just said amen, and all of a sudden my face changed. Somebody looked at me, I was like, yeah, she said, what's wrong with you? And I said, I'm just thinking about what's next. We hadn't even gotten out of the room, we hadn't even cleaned up yet. And I was already thinking about what's next. And I was like, wait, you need to enjoy what's now. And we'll get to what's next. And then this morning, as I parked my truck, and I walked down, y'all know the song, Soon and Very Soon, right? Soon and Very Soon, we're going to see the King. And I looked across the street, and the song came to my mind, Soon and Very Soon, that's going to be a thing.
All right.
Soon and Very Soon, that's going to be a thing. Soon and very soon, that's going to be a thing. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! That's going to be a thing. We'll host annual conference there. It's going to be a thing. God was teaching me. He said, don't worry about it yesterday. I'll show you when. And so now my focus has to be not on what I see, but on what he promised. Because then I'm keeping it real, because I've been set up with promises. Over and over again, God has been promising, I have a plan for you to prosper you and not to have to give you a hope and a future. All things work together. It's not right. It's not, but don't worry, they all work together. I can't take all of the pieces of the cake separately and enjoy them. I've got to put them together. And we need to keep it hopeful, because God is still alive. And if we believe that he rose again, we believe he's coming back. That's where we base our hope. Our hope is not based on how I feel. It's not based on what's going on around me. It's based on his promise. And his promise says, soon that thing he's been telling you, that business, that opportunity, that relationship, soon and very soon, it's going to be a thing. So that's what he tells you. It's going to be a thing. It's going to be a thing. Well, it's not a thing now. Okay. I'm still walking in that direction. Because I'm not walking in the direction of your word. I'm walking in the direction of his. Yeah. And if I keep walking in his direction, I'll get what he has planned. Therefore, because what do I know, everybody? He obviously plans extra. He plans extra. I was at dinner with the members of New Birth the other night, and they all ordered dinner, and they're sitting around eating, and all of a sudden a brother comes with extra fries. And somebody was like, did you order that? No, he just brought them to me. I got a God who just wants to bring me some extra fries. I didn't even order it. I wasn't even looking for it. And God's just saying, you know what? Hey, y'all go get him some extra. Why? Because he's in the place where I want him to be. And if we won't keep it hopeful, we gonna miss out on everything that he has. All right. I know the world, when you watch the news, I love it. You watch the news, 30 minutes of news. 29 minutes, man shot, woman shot, this gun, this gun, this burned down, this gun, this gun. And now for some good news. And you give me 29 minutes of bad news, and then wondering why some of us are all frowned up. Because we're so focused on CNN, we're so focused on Fox News, that we can't hear his news. Yeah. There's a reason why the gospel, the reason why he says, don't tell the good news. Because he's got good news. And good news is news of hope. Good news is news of confident expectation. I'm not wishing to get the property. I'm not dreaming to get the property. I'm expecting. Not based on our financial status. Not based on how many people we got or how many people are coming. It is based on the word of God. Yeah. He said, soon is very soon.
Yes.
Well, I don't know how. It doesn't matter how. It's the what that matters. Now, it's not even the what that matters. It's the who.
Yes.
And I don't trust Instagram. I trust Emmanuel. I trust God.
Yes.
And if we're going to trust God in this season of getting real, if we're going to keep it real, we need to keep real hopeful. Because that means there's something else coming. And I said, he says, hey, keep your mind thinking something good's going to happen.
Yeah, yeah.
Some of us are always waiting for the other shoe to fall.
Amen.
Oh, yeah. It's going too good right now. Something bad about to happen.
No.
And then when it happened, now you're all mad at God. Well, you've been calling it up.
Yeah, yeah.
Something bad.
Yeah.
Somebody says, ask and you shall receive. Seek, you shall find. What you looking for? I'm looking for this bad thing to happen. Look, you keep the bad thing. I'm going with what God said. Now, on the way to what God said, something bad might happen, but I'm not focused on that, because the light and momentary troubles by no means compare to the eternal weight of glory that is in Christ Jesus. So my hope is not here, my hope is out there.
Yeah.
So look, keep it hopeful, because we've been set up with promises. But then the next three verses, he says, hey, as obedient children, I can't wait to teach on that on Thursday, do not be conformed to the desires of your former ignorance. But as the one who has called you is holy, you also are to be holy in, that says all. It doesn't say be holy when you come to church. It doesn't say holy at Sunday school. Holy when your mama around. Holy when the pastor kicked your car and you gotta change the radio station. It doesn't say that. I must see. Some of y'all so funny, I get in the car, y'all be like, pass, I'm sorry. But if you can listen to with God in the car, why are you worried about me in the car? Yeah, I'm sorry, that's on the other side. Okay. Be holy in all your conduct. For it is written, be holy, because I am holy. If we're going to keep it real, we got to keep it real holy, because we've been set apart as for children.
Yes.
Somebody said, well, you're different. You're supposed to be different. You didn't realize all of us are different? Every last one of us is different. And you know what? We were born originals. We were created originals. And we spend the rest of our lives trying to be copies. God formed you. How many Mona Lisas did he paint? No, he had to paint more than one. So Mona Lisa sitting around here trying to look like everybody else. Do you really think a Ferrari, if a Ferrari had a personality, do you think a Ferrari is driving down the road going, I don't look like all the Ford? Now Ferrari's saying that for us. Like, yes, I'm different. That's why my value is so high. And we running around here like, well, I need to dress like him. I need to be like him. No, be holy. Be set apart. Be different. Peter said in 1 Peter 2, at 9 and 10, he talks about that we are a chosen generation.
Yeah.
A royal priesthood.
Yeah.
A peculiar people.
Yeah.
We are supposed to be different. Joy. Find the joy in your difference, because then you are set apart. See, we've got this picture that holiness is some kind of, you know, well, you know how I always say it, we don't smoke, drink, or chew, or go with girls who do. That makes us holy. Ernie, when I take that to the Unbeliever's Bible. Unbeliever's Bible, 2 Hesitations 9:4. That's not holiness. Holiness is becoming and being transformed to be more like God. Talisa, thank you. Because when you started going holy, you know, God has never called love, love, love. He's never called power, power, power. He's never called glory, glory, glory. But he is called holy, holy. What is holy? He's completely set apart. Like I heard y'all talk about yesterday, he don't care what y'all say. He's still who he is. We run around, we won't do what we were made to do because we're afraid somebody might not look like it. They're going to cut their eyes at us. What if they don't applaud? And I shared this yesterday. You know why it took 10 years? 10 years to have Get Real? God was afraid what y'all was going to say. What if they don't show up? What if they don't like it? What if they don't? What if they don't? What if they don't? What if they don't? And God was like, who are they? He said, I'm completely real. I love them. But they can't stop my purpose. So until I made it up in my mind that I was going to be set apart, and whether all of you came or none of you came, we were having a conference. Because the ultimate goal, once we talk about this last thing, the goal wasn't to please you. The goal was to please him. And when we put our foot in the water, when we stepped out from the crowd, when we decided to be different, God showed up.
Yeah.
That's up. Because we made a commitment that we were going to be whole.
Yes.
We were going to be more. We were going to be better. We were going to be different. Yes. And God is calling you to be different.
Yes.
He's looking at you saying, why are you acting like them? Because they're the cool people. I didn't call you to be cool. I called you to be what I made you to be. And so holiness matters. Is my mic on?
Yeah,
it's on. I have my song. No, we did this in Seattle, Check. Check one. That one ain't on. Check.
That
one's working. That one's working.
One.
Thank you, Morgan.
Moses. Pharaoh, I'm sorry. Let my people go. I need Prashant. Where's Prashant? I'm sorry. Yeah. So, holy. Keep it holy. I think I shared with you one day where these guys were talking and somebody said, oh, you're so holy. And the guy was fighting against kid being called holy. But later on, somebody called him a pimp. And he was like, yeah. I said, wait a minute. So you don't want to be holy, but you want to be a pimp. I said, what world do we live in right now? And so church, do you want to be holy? Or do you want to be pimps and pimpettes? I want to be cool. I want people to like me. Well, what about God? And we need to keep it holy because we are different people. We have a different set of rules. We have a different lifestyle. Truly, the alternative lifestyle isn't them. The alternative lifestyle is us. Because they're just doing what sinners do. We are doing something different. And if we're going to keep it real, we've got to keep it real different. We've got to keep it real holy. Now, we're not being different just for the sake of being different, to be difficult. We're being different because we are different. Because my daddy is different. How many of your parents said that you said, hey, they're getting to go to the concert? And your parents said, and they don't live here. They're not my child. Guess what God is saying when you tell him, well, God, everybody else doing it. And my child, you are holy.
Yes.
You are set apart. Yes. Now, really, isn't the question of whether you are holy? The question of whether you're going to live holy. Am I going to live as I already am? Okay. See, here's an example I'm going to give you. Some of us were that kid in school that we knew all the answers in class. They answered questions, some of us, not all of us. Some of us. We were sitting in class, and the teacher had, and we had all the answers. And what did all the other kids do when you had all the answers?
Look at
the right? You said, you the teacher's pet. You just, you making us look bad. I said, no, you were making you look bad. You didn't do the homework. Why are you mad at me?
Yeah, exactly.
But what did some of us do when they kept telling you what you were and they called you something? What did you do? You stopped raising your hand. See, you were different. You were set apart. But then you decided, you know what? Maybe I'll be like them. That didn't stop in the third grade. Some of us are doing it at work. We've been different. And then, oh, look at you, so holy. Look at you. Oh, you look at the little church boy going. And we put our hand down.
Yeah.
We went to the beauty shop to come to church, but we go to the beauty shop and we act. Never mind. I'm sorry. Because we want to fit in. And how do we call that real? That's not real. That's real fake. Actually, that's what that is. That's real fake. Look at my diamond. It's not a diamond, it's a diamel. But we're wearing it. We're talking about it. And some of us are living a diamel life when God has called us to be diamonds. And so I need us to keep it real holy because we've been set apart as peculiar. Sonia, I know you hate it when I do this, but I think I say this every September. You know, we've got some dishes in the house. My grandmother gave us some china, and we don't use the china every day. And I want to let y'all know, even though we love you, when you come over to the house on the 30th, you get paper plates. Okay, I'm keeping it real. I'm just gonna let you know, you get paper plates. The china is reserved for different occasions, huh? You want to use the china this year? I don't care what you want to use. I'm not putting my foot down on this one. The china's staying in the cabinet this year. But why? Because it was set apart. It was set apart for something different. And guess what, y'all? You've been set apart for something different. And we can't keep involving ourselves in foolishness that does not belong to us. What does it say? Don't ever fight with the pig because you both end up money and the pig likes it. You've been set apart. But when we keep getting involved in what they do and what they say and how they say it, we are no longer keeping it real. We have fallen into a trap because our Father is holy. And because He is holy, we should be holy as well. So as you continue to read, he talks about how we've been bought with a price. We've been set free. And then you get down to verse 22 of 1 Peter chapter 1. And he says this very, he says, since you have purified yourselves by your obedience to the truth, so that you show sincere brotherly love for each other from a pure heart of conscience, love one another constantly. So I absolutely need you to keep it real hopeful. I need you to keep it real holy. But last but not least, I need you to keep it real helpful because we've been set free for a purpose. God has set us free, not so that we can satisfy our own desires, but so that we're free to meet your needs. We talked about it yesterday in the men's session. I'll share what we talked about a little bit. That I asked the question, I asked the brother, I said, hey man, how's your love life? And all the brothers, I be holding it down. You know how I do. And I said, that's our problem. Because our problem is love equals sex. But somehow, the way I love my wife probably should be the same way I love my kids. I think that's against the law. And so if love is only sex, then we've got a problem. Because our love, this says love one another constantly. This ain't that kind of church. Our love should look like something. They should be able to see. How do you know I love you? Because I told you? No, because some of you ladies know some brother told you he loved you. And then there were some actions.
that spoke louder than those words. So just because it came out of here doesn't mean it's true. Love is a lifestyle. Love is an action. And so if we love each other, I should be helping you and not hurting you. And if we're going to keep it real, we of all people should be keeping it real helpful. We should be meeting needs. We talked about this in Sunday school this morning. That's why I got so excited. I was like, God, I love the way you be putting everything together. Because we talked about it. Jesus healed the man. The man didn't ask. But the man had a need. And Jesus reached in to the need.
Yeah.
We sitting around making decisions. Oh, they don't need it. They don't want it. They don't deserve it. Da-da-da. How did all y'all do in your mind reading class? Anybody pass their mind reading class? Now y'all feel so you don't know what's going on, but you can see a need. And if we are going to be the church of God, if we are going to be children of God, if we are going to be Christ-like, we should be helpful. Somebody is drowning, we just talking to them, boy, you shouldn't be out there. I don't know why you got out there in the first place. You know you couldn't swim well enough to be out there. Didn't you see the signs? The signs said don't swim. Ain't no lifeguard on duty. The world is drowning and all we can do is talk about it. You shouldn't have had those babies. Well, you might be right, but I did have them. Now help me. Well, you shouldn't be that. Well, you're right. You might be right. I shouldn't have fallen down, but since I'm down, could you please? Help me, y'all. We've got to keep it real helpful. Because he set us free. The Bible says we were bought with a price. You are a priceless individual. You are not set free. I'm going to do my own thing. We were set free to do God's thing. And God's thing is helping people. You know how I know his thing is helping people? Because he helped y'all. We talked about this in the men's class too. We talked about what do you do when your wife wants to do something you don't want to do?
And all of us said, well,
we do it because we're trying to stay married. But then we broke it down and said, you know what? Actually, you know what? We're only doing it because we're doing what Jesus did. Because please recognize, Trishawn, you know this very well. He didn't want to die. Oh no, Jesus came because he loved me. No, Jesus was in the garden. Got on his phone with his father and said, yo, Pop, can we do it any other way? We can speak something into existence and it'll just happen. I don't want to do this. But not my will, but your will. See, I told you his will was, y'all go home. Peter, James, John. Sonia, Trinity, y'all on your own because I don't want this. But because my daddy said, I'm going to do it. And so, what does your daddy want you to do? I want to help them. Didn't ask you if you wanted to. I just told you to do it. If you do it, maybe your want to will come, maybe it won't. But otherwise, because see, here's the problem. We wait till we want to help people and they starving. Yeah. We wait till we want to and they dying.
Yeah.
Even worse, we're waiting till we want to and they're killing themselves. But we see a need, and we as the church, we said it before, we exist to meet needs. And somewhere, I think it still says that God has set up good works for you to do in advance.
Yes.
And so we are walking by needs every day, not accidentally, but because God needs us to keep it helpful. Will we keep it helpful? Are we just going to do, we're going to serve the homeless on Christmas Eve and then be done for the next 364 days? Well, remember back when we served the homeless? You know, they were homeless a day later, too. They were hungry then too. Now, am I telling you gotta solve every issue? No, you can't do that. But y'all remember the starfish story, right? Little girl walking on the beach. She's throwing thousands of starfish on the beach, and she's throwing them back one by one, and the guy is watching her for a few minutes. And then eventually the guy comes down and he says, little girl, what are you doing? And she says, I'm saving the starfish.
And he looks up and down the beach and he says, little girl, there are too many starfish. It's impossible for you to make a difference. To that, the little girl picks up a starfish. She looks at it. She throws it back in the water and she says, I made a difference to that one. Nobody asked you to save Shreveport. Can you just save the people in your house? I didn't ask you to help all of Bossier City. I just asked you to help the one person that came to you and had a need. I ain't asking you to pray for and listen to everybody, but the one who did come into contact with you, maybe you stop talking about what you can't do and do what you can. Because if we're going to be the church God wants us to be, we've got to keep it real helpful. Because if we're not going to be helpful, what were we set free for in the first place? He released us. We talk about Harriet Tubman. We celebrate Harriet Tubman every February. Oh, Harriet Tubman, Harriet Tubman. I don't know why she ain't doing nothing. She did. Because she got her freedom and then went back to help other people be free. We got our freedom and talk about all those who are still bound. It would be like Harriet in the paper. Yeah, them slaves down there, they just down there doing all that work for master. And we wouldn't like Harriet if she did that. But then she would just sound like the Church of God in 2023. We got set free, and we're gonna talk about them. We're still bound. That's not helping anyone. That's not helpful. And so, Peter is giving us a challenge. He gave us a challenge to start the year. We're going to try to finish this year. And my prayer is that we would indeed keep it real.
Amen.
I don't want to just keep it real like the world talks about keeping it real, because I want us to keep it real, hopeful. God's got a plan. Soon and very soon.
Yes.
That's about to be a thing. Now, I know what my thing is that I'm looking for and I believe in God for, but I also believe that God has spoke something into your spirit, and he said, if you will ride with me, soon and very soon, that's going to be a thing. And while you are waiting for that thing, keep it holy. Remember who you are. You are a priceless child of God. You are different on purpose. You walk like it. One of my favorite stories, speaking of slavery, one of my favorite stories is they had this slave auction, and all the slaves were kind of standing there bent down, and they were beaten, and there was this one brother just standing there all tall. And one of the guys on the auction said, hey, what's wrong with that brother right there? Oh, he's the son of a king. He doesn't recognize that he's a slave. Okay. He was in chains. He was butt naked. They were trying to buy him, but his mind said, I know who I am. The chains don't make me. The clothes don't make me. What makes me is my relationship to my Father.
Yeah.
And if we would remember that relationship, we can keep it holy.
Yeah.
I don't do that. Why? Because you don't want to get caught? No, because my people don't do that. Well, it used to be right. I used to do it. I used to wet my pants. But I grew out of that too. And so I don't do this foolishness because I am holy. If we keep it holy, if we keep it hopeful, then please, please, let's keep it helpful.
Amen.
Everybody breathe in, breathe out. You're supposed to help somebody today. Now, if you did not do that, we'll go ahead and have your service right now. And you were off the hook. You don't have to help nobody else. But if you've got breath in your lungs, God woke you up not by accident, on purpose, for a purpose. And that purpose was not about you getting prettier, about you getting stronger, about you getting richer, about you getting something. Your purpose was about you giving. And so that way you would keep it real helpful. Now, Sister Smith, I know you know this because you'd be watching TV Jakes at the same time. I'm like, one day we just won't call each other and watch TV Jakes together and just get our own shout out. But one day he said, you know, being relentless will get you there. Being consistent will keep you there, and being grateful will increase what's there. I said, well, I wish I had said that. I probably should have told you that was T.D. Jakes. But see, you know what God does? See, I watch T.D. Jakes, and I didn't want to post stuff, but I know Sister Smith be watching too. She'd be like, Pastor. Now you know, TD said that on Tuesday morning. And now you on Sunday talking about, wow, I'm kicking it out. I'm like, man, Pastor, give credit where credit is due. That's how God keeps me, he keeps me from plagiarizing. But here you go. Being relentless will help us get real. But being consistent will keep us real. And as I said yesterday, I'm so glad the feedback that I've received for the conference has been amazing. But the feedback don't matter if the life doesn't change.
All right.
If we go back into the cocoon, we wasted our time. We wasted a lot of money. We had a good couple of hours, but it wasn't for, it'd be like a plane on the runway. If you're playing this evening, it's on the runway and it goes to take off and it just drives around the runway. No, that's not what it was supposed to do. God has put us on the runway and he's got us rolling down and we're just about that point. Are we going to take off or are we just going to touch right back down again? It's up to us. God won't do it for us. All I can hear him saying is keep it real. Keep it real hopeful. Because I've got a promise for you. Keep it real holy. Because I am holy. Keep it real helpful. Because your love needs to look like something. And if we will do that, we will keep it real. Because we serve a real God. Amen. Let's just pray.
Eternal God,
forgive us. Forgive us for all those times that we chose to do our own thing, to live our own way. All those times that we decided to listen to what the world would say and we walked as around as people who had no hope. God, forgive us for all those times that we conformed to the world instead of being transformed by the renewing of our minds. Forgive us for all those times that we did not want to be holy, even though we already are holy. And God, forgive us for all those times that we had an opportunity to help, but we chose ourselves instead. We chose our convenience. We chose our opportunities. It's mine. I can do what I want. But God, we forgot that we are not our own, that we have been bought with a price, that you own us, and we are your servants. So now, God, I pray that from this point forward, we as a church, not the building, but the bodies in the building and online, we would keep it real. That we would be holy, helpful, and hopeful. And that the world would change because we are walking in the path of our God. I thank you, Father, for who you are and that you've given us another chance. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
One other thing about a lot of that scripture, it kept talking about our Father. Actually, if you read the precursor, verses 3 through 12, it's all about being saved. Because verse 13 starts with therefore, which means it's connected to everything else. Therefore, if you are not saved, all of the stuff that I talked about, it means nothing to you. It was oh, he was so cute. Oh, you're still going to hell. Pastor, that's mean. I'm just keeping it real. We can do all the church service we want to do, take all the sacraments we want to take, say all the prayers we want to say. None of that's going to get you to heaven. What gets you to heaven is a relationship with Jesus Christ. And so if you don't know if you have that relationship, if you're not sure if you have that relationship, then today, let's be sure. Why go through life wondering if you have a chance? I don't know about you, but when I wonder about what's in my bank account, I don't just stand around going, huh, I wonder how much money I got. You know what I do? I check it. I call the bank, I go to my app, I go, oh yeah, look at this. Well, I'm asking for a check your salvation account. Check it right now. Don't wonder. Check it. And if your account is empty, I know a guy. I don't even know a guy. I know one guy. And I would love to introduce you to him so that you could be saved, not just for heaven, but for today. If you need a church home, I think I recognize everybody here, y'all belong, but that's okay, just in case. St. Mary's open. St. Mary's open to you. One of the things on Google you know, we're on Google and all these things, and every time I click on the Google site, it says closed. And it bothers me when I see the church is closed. Because the church, the building is closed. The church is always open. And I want to invite you to be a part of the church that is in the building so that you can connect with the churches that are always open. And so if you don't have a church home, I'd be honored to be your pastor. Now, obviously, I've been told if you want a singing pastor, I'm not the guy. If you want a hooping pastor, I'm not the guy.
All right.
But if you want a pastor that's going to love you and teach you the word of God,
yes.
I just might be the guy. And so I offer myself to you to serve you as your pastor. And if in this real world you're in some real pain, I want to invite you to pray. Because one of the problems with a message like that is some people believe that I am negating what they're going through. But please remember who this letter was written to. This letter was written to people who were struggling. Peter wrote it to people who were being persecuted and abused. He wrote it to you. And he still said, keep it whole. Keep it healthy. And keep it hopeful. So if you're in the midst of one of those situations, if you recognize you're one who Peter is speaking to, come on, let's pray. Because I want to speak the hope that God has for you, into you, in this moment. So is there one that needs Jesus? Please come. Is there one that needs a church home? Please come. Is there one that needs to pray? Please come. The altar is open. Is there another? Let's pray. Father God, in the midst of us needing to be helpful, we are calling you for help. Lord God, these have come with so many different things because they're different. But you are the same God. Yesterday, today, and forever, you are the God who is able to do all things well. God, some have come because they have family members that are sick, that are very sick, and the doctors don't know what to do. But you are the ultimate doctor. You are Jehovah Rapha, the God who heals. And so, God, we ask you to attend to these cases. God, whether you do it by miracle or medicine, we will praise you. Because we understand that all healing comes from you. And God, while we wait for the healing for those that we love, we pray your comfort. We need comfort emotionally, mentally, and physically, God. God, some of us are struggling because we never knew pain like this before. But you are the God of all comfort. God, help us in this moment to find rest in your arms. Jesus called out, "Come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Not just rest for your body, but rest for your soul. Rest for your mind, will, and emotions. God, open your arms and receive them now. Hold them as only you can. Give them that profound sense of your presence, that there is no doubt that you are holding them and holding them together. Your word says that Jesus holds all things together. And God, right now, for those that are here that are mourning, hold them together, God. Every step, don't let them go. As a matter of fact, God, pick them up and carry them through the valley. When they can't walk on their own, God, surround them with people who will love them and hold on to them and lead them. God, there's been gun violence again. Foolishness has been close to the hearts of some of us. God, we don't understand it, and so we need you to step in. God, show us how we can be helpful in these situations, because we don't know what to do. But your word says, if any of you lack wisdom, ask God. God, we're asking. Give us wisdom. But not just wisdom for life. Give us wisdom in school. God, so many things are attacking our children right now. We pray your protection, most of all of their minds, so that they can focus on what they've been called and created to do, God. God, you have put such wonderful gifts and abilities into our young people. And we ask that you will guide them so those gifts and abilities, they'll come out. Lord God, where there's confusion, we pray wisdom. Where there is discomfort, we pray peace. Where there is anxiousness, God, we pray your presence. Give them the strength of mind, body, and soul to succeed in the classes that they are in right now, God. Understanding that where they're at now doesn't define where they're about to be, because you are taking them somewhere greater. God, we pray for hope. Some of us are so close to what we've experienced, to the pain that we feel, that that's all we can see. God, I pray that you give us an X-ray vision, that we can see through the problems, that we can see through the pain, so that we can see your promise. God, I don't need you to take the pain away, but I need you to give us hope. Help us to see beyond what we see, so we can see what's really there to be seen. God, we know there's something better. We know there's something greater, but sometimes it gets so hard. But like we prayed for your comfort, God, we pray for your vision. We pray that we would see with your eyes what's out there and what's around us. God, we thank you that you've even still made promises. We thank you that we're not at the end. We thank you that there's still something to come. Give us the strength to hope. Like Abraham, God, help us to hope against hope. When hope makes no sense, God, help us to hope anyway. Because we want everything that you've got planned for us. God, we pray healing for those that are standing here physically. Lord, God, we thank you for where you brought them from, but there's still so much pain. God, the medicine's not helping like we thought it would. So God, we need you to step in. We need you to step in. You know every joint. You made it. You know every cell. You made them. God, fix it. We are seeking your help. And Lord, when we are weak in those situations, remind us that in you we are strong. God, we have come because we need you. We have come because friends and family need you. We have come because you are our only hope for our kids and our grandkids, for our spouses, God, for everyone that's connected to us. We invite you to come in with power and with grace, because we need you in every one of these ways. And God, for those who didn't come to the altar, those who are on Facebook, those who are on Zoom, those that have their own prayer requests, their own pains, God, hear them. Because I know you don't have to hear me. Hear them, God, and respond as only you can. God, I thank you for healing. I thank you for comfort. I thank you for better grades.
Yes.
I thank you for better relationships. I thank you for better opportunities. I thank you for a better vision. I thank you for feeling better, because we are going to call those things which are not as those they are, as though they are, because we are keeping it hopeful, because we serve a God of hope. God, I thank you. I praise you. We magnify you in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 God bless you. Keep you. Is our prayer. Let's see, as we prepare to close, again, we thank you for everything. I've been calling them out several times, and I'm so excited. So yesterday, Ernie and Ronna Kasem came and participated in Get Real. They spoke to the marriage, and I've known Ernie. I knew Ernie before I knew Linda. I still like her more than you, though, but that's all right. But
I like her more than you.
That's true. I don't blame you for that either. But Ernie and I were on active duty together, and we went through a lot at that time and life, but God is so good that he has kept us connected. And so Ernie and Ron are family, and it's so good to see family here. And so thank you for coming all the way from Sacramento, California.
Yeah.
Thank you for fighting through the devil that is American Airlines. And we are praying your safe passage back. And we are looking forward to sharing with you again really, really soon. So thank you. Let's see. I don't know what's next, but I'm excited about it. Because I know who's got next. And God's got our next, everybody. And so let us be people of hope and joy, even if we don't see it, because we walk by and not by
sight.
And my faith says, get ready, get ready, get ready. Because it's about to be amazing. Eye has not seen, ear has not heard, neither has entered into the mind of man what God has prepared for those that love him. But he has revealed it to us by his spirit. And my spirit's saying, ooh, you gonna like this. And I'm excited, and I pray that you were excited with me. And so let's just get ready to go out and change this world. One life at a time. All right? Let's pray. God, thank you. Thank you for the music. Thank you for the prayers. Thank you for hearing our prayers. Thank you for answering our prayers. Thank you for not giving us what we want, but what we need. Thank you for the presence of your people. Thank you for the technology that allows us to broadcast to the people. Thank you for the gifts that were demonstrated in this building today, but thank you even more for the gifts that we will demonstrate out there. Thank you for the opportunity to be helpful, to be hopeful, and to be holy. Thank you for wanting to be with us, to relate with us, and to use us. Thank you for setting us free. Thank you for feeding us your word. Thank you for being our Father. God, now help us to live as obedient children, walking in your purpose and doing your will. Now, unto him who is able to do immeasurably more than we ask or imagine, through the power that is at work within us, that only wise God be dominion, honor, glory, and power, now and forevermore. And all those that are going to keep it real said,
amen. Amen.
God bless you and keep you is my prayer.
Jesus.